Just a very short introduction about myself. My name is Eben John. I work as an Agile coach with Societe Generale Global Solution Center. As an Agile coach, I had worked with companies like Nokia Siemens Networks, GE, Alcatel-Lucent, Voltec, etc. So I am interested in NLP, Neuro-Linguistic Programming, and a little bit of behavioral and psychological aspects of human beings. So one of the Harvard review, which actually inspired me to create this particular deck, this is the first time I'm delivering this topic in half an hour. So I have, to maximize your value add, I've removed a couple of things, some exercises, etc. So let's bear with me and let's see how can we create more value add. Yep. To help you to use your law of 2 feet, I'll first straight away tell you what is the objective. One of the objectives is to establish the or throw some light into this relation between size and productivity. And the second one is about some factors affecting the team dynamics. And with that context, how these things are getting affected in some of the ceremonies what we do as part of our Scrum or Agile principles. Yeah? So how many of you have design teams? Hope a lot of managers around here. So normally when we think about designing a team, what are things we normally think about? We want to have everything optimum. Optimum productivity, optimum motivation, transparency, collaboration, a lot of things. Right? We do a lot of homework before we create a team. It's not that every Tom, Dick, and Harry can come into a group and then we call it a team, right? But today we are focusing more on size, how the size impact on productivity. So if you look around in the different places in the day-to-day lives, we see in sports, different games have different team sizes. You have baseball, 9 people, basketball, 5, cricket, 11. Many times you would have taken this for granted. We are not questioning why there is different team sizes. So, but it's almost certain that the team size have significant impact on performance. So there are a lot of people did a lot of studies to identify what is the real relation, what is the optimum number, etc. So I'm throwing some light into this, and probably you have a lot of ideas about that already, and it's a debatable topic anyway. So let's look at what I have. So there's a scientist, a French scientist called Ringelmann, have done some studies, and it's now known as Ringelmann effect. He says that the size of the group diminishes the performance. The bigger the group, the lesser the performance. Which normally not the way we think, because many times we heard stories, okay, if you can't meet the deadline, add a couple more people, finish it off. And we know, for practical reasons, it's not working that way. So individual performance is inversely proportional to the productivity, but it can't go to zero and say that, okay, if there's nobody or one person can create everything. That's also not true. So there is a down limit and there is an upper limit. So what he have done in order to arrive into this conclusion? He have done some exercise, pretty interesting. It's a rope pulling exercise. He asked 4 people to pull a rope and he measured the tension at the other end. Then he asked 4 more people to join. So they pulled the rope. Any guesses about the result? Yeah. Yes. 8 people could not pull as strong as 4 people. Thought-provoking, isn't it? So he concluded this as loss of coordination. So we know that when we add more people, we get into a lot of coordination problems. So he concluded, yes, this could be a coordination problem. But is it only that? I think we end up having a lot of incidents in similar lines where we add more people into the team and we don't get the result, even in fact the outcome will reduce. Even in the keynote speak yesterday, Craig was talking about 250 people working instead of 25 people. Because many times we have wrong metrics where the manager is measured with the number of people who is reporting to him. We have a lot of examples about that. So there is another exercise conducted on top of this. It's an extension to this. University professor called Alan Ingham have done similar exercise and he have got similar results, but he added a small twist. So what happened was, in the same rope pulling exercise, when he asked other people to join, he said, you don't have to pull it, just pretend as if you're pulling. What would have happened? Irrespective of whether I'm part of a big team, I thought as part of a big team, I work less hard. Because I feel less responsible about the outcome. I have less ownership. I'm not very much accountable. So he concluded, yes, it's not only the coordination, there is something else called social loafing. I think many people could relate to social loafing here. Okay, so coordination is another topic which probably we all try to find different tools to get it through. Let's look more into the social loafing, which is pretty interesting for me, because when I do a research on this stuff, I've realized why I behave in certain way in certain circumstances. At this moment, I'm a victim of social loafing. My hand is, you know. So it's part of it. So social loafing is a phenomena where there is a reduction when you work with a larger group. When you work alone, you would have produced certain result, but when you work in a big group, you will tend to produce lesser result. So there are a lot of aspects to it. The main thing is, as we discussed, the responsibility factor. And so if you go deeper into social loafing consists of two major parameters. One is social facilitation and another one is social influence. So we will go dive into it and we'd like to see, I actually really want to open up what really makes us do many things. And for example, like say you would have met a lot of people in the last 2 days. When you had discussion, especially me, when I had discussion with a couple of people, I tend to say yes, 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 even though I don't understand. And I'll end up asking wrong questions because I asked him, which company do you work for? He'll say one company name. And I didn't understand. I didn't catch because there are a lot of companies, right? So it was not a familiar name for me. And after some time, we had a lot of discussion about the way you work, etc. At the end, I'll ask the question again, which company you work for? It's so you understand the, you know, he'll say, okay, I'm talking to the wrong guy, he'll just go away, right? Okay, so about social facilitation. It's a tendency for people to do better on simple tasks. On the other hand, the performance will degrade a task which is less familiar. For example, I'm an agile coach. I preach about a manifesto most of the time. Whoever I meet, who is in working waterfall, oh, you work in waterfall, why not agile? I can preach about it because I know the things pretty clearly. At least I am confident about it, so I'm not worried. I do a good job. And when there are more people joining to listen to me, I'll get a boost. I'll get more confidence. But the moment somebody asks me to fix a JUnit test code, I'll get into trouble. I'm not very familiar. So, suppose with all the knowledge I have, I was a programmer, so probably I could fix it. But I would have taken some time if I given all the freedom to sit and understand this, Google it, do something, right? But if there is somebody watching me, then that's going to go down. Most of the time I'll be thinking about, is he seeing me? I'm a professional coach, and if he know that I don't know about Jai Unit, it's a problem. Right? How many times we get into such situation? We talk about micromanagement many times. This is exactly what happens when manager come and sit on your lap and then look at your monitor all the time. Okay, let me see how you're progressing. You get a call every time, every half an hour, somebody will ping you. What is it? What happens? Is it working? So you create a pressure, and which will internally take the outcome out of you. Okay, let's move on. Social influence, again, another interesting stuff. And by the way, it's not only about our work life. This is applicable outside also, probably which you can relate to. Social influence is when emotions, opinions, and behavior of one person is affected by others or a group. So it has a couple of more factors. It has three general factors and two psychological factors. Let's see, what are they? The first one is about complaints. When people appear to agree with the crowd, even though they have a difference of opinion. For example, I'm talking about something and it seems like everybody is agreeing because everybody is attending, everybody is laughing and clapping. So one person have a difference of opinion, he just suppress it because I don't want to be the odd man out. Right? So it's a phenomena. It's not only working with me, it's with everybody. So just relax. So second one is about identification. When you have a celebrity, whom do you think that he knows everything about that particular topic? And when he talks about it, you tend to do, you know, okay, yeah, it may be true. For example, Sachin Tendulkar talking about batting. Probably you don't go and challenge him that, you know, what you say is not right. Yeah? And the third one is about internalization. This is also have some connection with what we discussed today morning, where Mary Papandik was talking about self-fulfilling prophecies. When you're a kid, you started singing, you are not worried about who is watching you. You don't have any social influence at that point of time, you're not aware. So you started singing, but your father probably, I don't know whether father or mother who have more understanding about singing, he'll say, oh, that's not the way, you can't sing. Come on, you're my kid, right? So he started taking that thought and internalizing that. Okay, I can't sing. I'm not a programmer. I'm not good at doing that. I'm not good at doing this. I'm not good at talking to people. Different things. When many people start giving you that inputs, you will internalize that. And that become one of your belief and end up being a blocker for you. Okay? So moving on to the psychological aspects. So there are two things. One is informational social influence and normative social influence. The informational social influence is the need to be right. This is one phenomena which probably kicks in many times in many meetings. Right? I coined in the term where probably somebody had challenged and then I end up having a lot of discussion with them and eventually I realize, yes, there is a problem with my idea, but I put it through, so I need to, you know, win. It'll become a competition, and at the end of the day, you will get into very wrong outputs, very wrong decisions, right? For example, like say, outside, you go to temple, and you have no much idea about how to behave inside a temple. What do you normally do? You look at a person, other person who is actually, you know, looks like familiar to the setup, and the way he behaves is something which you are going to mimic. So you have an inherent psychological need to be right. And the second portion is about normative social influence. So the need to be liked. This is something which kicks in most of the ceremonies which we do. Probably I'm anyway going back and iterating through our ceremonies and how these are affecting that. But here, when somebody is, say, a senior member, the product owner, is talking about the feature, he's telling that this is a feature which we user need, probably you may have a better idea. Right? But you won't cut him, you don't challenge him for different reasons. On the other side, like say, come out of our office, your girlfriend or your wife is asking, how do I look? The need to be liked comes out. Say, oh, wonderful. Yeah, I think people. Wonderful. You're realizing that. Yes. So moving on. See, why am I talking all these psychological stuff, behavioral stuff here? How is it affecting? And what is the connection between the agile way of doing things and this informational social loafing, social influence, etc.? So if you think about different things what we do on a daily basis, on a weekly basis, on an iterative basis, like say for example task breakdown, estimation. Why do you think when we do poker planning, we estimate and keep it down? Because you don't want to get influenced. Now why do you think in grooming meetings, or rather many times if you go, I worked as a consultant, or I consulted companies for specification by example. So when you go to the teams and then ask them, what are the biggest challenge you have? They say requirement, understanding the requirement. So did you have a grooming meeting? Yes. But what happened there? We thought, we assumed that this is that way, this is this way, etc. Because we don't tend to ask questions. Because we don't like challenging people, because we think that if I challenge them, they may not like me. Things are kicking in again. All these psychological things are coming in actually a couple of times in every day in different situations. So being aware of that itself can help you to see what is the reality. Yeah? So we are heading about the ideal number. What's the ideal number? Any guesses? 8, 7, 5, 5. Okay. So yeah, we can have a debate maybe. Probably anyway, after this we have a coffee break. So we can debate about it. But in the research which I've done, the ideal number turned to be 4 to 5. So anything smaller than 4 is too less to be effective. Anything more than 5, 6 is going to be too big. We know that different situation. For example, like say take an accident situation where somebody met with an accident and fallen down. If there is only 3 or 4 people, it's very likely that that person will get a help. But if you have a huge crowd, most of the time everybody will just look around and then go back. Yeah? So, but depending on the context, it can change, because we talk about cross-functionality, self-organizing, and for different purpose we create teams. So the context matters. But anything more than 6, 7 is going to be a problem. We know that. We already experienced that. And today, just before me, there was a talk about Are We There Yet? By Aslam. So he was also talking about, he's shown us a couple of case studies. In one of the case studies, it was surprising to me that a team had 5 people. 5 people created 80% of work, completed 80% of the work, but 20 people team could complete only 50%. Many times we don't, you know, connect with that, because we have very funny studies. Project management or product management does a lot of funny things. Like say one lady can produce a kid in 9 months. 9 ladies can produce 9 kids in 9 months. Why not 9 ladies in 1 month produce 1 kid? This is the way they ask questions. Right? Okay. Let's move on. So small teams are more effective. When given the same circumstances, if people are capable, they tend to self-organize better. The synergy will be much more when we have small teams. So changing size may not be an option. Now, okay, fine, we understand everything. We will tend to, you know, look at it when we start a new team. But currently we are working with a lot of teams. What can we do about it? I have some suggestions, probably which some of them you already practice, but let's look at it. But doing nothing is not an option, because all these overheads will sit on the highest performers. And those are the guys who get, you know, because of social loafing, the people who are getting affected are the highest performers, and they will, it's risky for you. Right? So the other options, option number one is about creating small tasks and make each one accountable. So this is what we do as part of our Scrum task board. We have small tasks. When the moment somebody picks it up and move it to the in-progress state, we'll write the name. So we will make him accountable for that. The moment you have your name attached to it and hanging around in the in-progress state for more than 2-3 days, it's a problem. right, you feel little worried. I had friends who comes to the scrum meeting and talk for around 3 minutes, and they will have the same story hanging around there because they think that just fool the system by telling that I did this, I did do, I did that, I helped them, I was solving problem for somebody else, etc. Will actually create an impression. But the moment you see things hanging in the board, which will actually tell you something. And second is about creating a sense of urgency. If you have read about Kota's principle, this is the first thing he talk about, create a sense of urgency. It's not about pushing people to work on late night. It's about giving them something to care more than themselves. Right? When you know that you don't have any deadlines, you don't have any time, or nobody is waiting, then you tend to book your movie tickets than looking at some breaking code. So try to give them a little sense of urgency which can motivate them positively. But you have to sense it. And the third one is about making the weaker link in the team responsible for the team's outcome. So nobody wants to be the weakest link in the team. So there's a principle, a effect called Kohler effect, where the moment a weaker link is exposed, he'll try to catch up with other people. So eventually the outcome of the team, the group outcome will improve. And the fourth option is about providing greater transparency, opening up your feedback system, 360-degree feedback, making things painfully visible. That's what we talk most of the time, right? In Agile, we use visual methods and make things visible so that people will feel that, yeah, I'm not doing good. So you have information radiators in and around the development places where when you look at it, you'll see a red light. Then you will know, I need to fix something or something is breaking. I need to do something about it. So that will give you an intrinsic motivation to do a fixing. Okay, when I say responsibility, it is not about giving them some power to do some changes. It's about making him responsible for the failure. The team is not proceeding as it would have if you perform better. So we are going to make him understand that if you take little more ownership, things are going to move faster. So we will make him realize that, yeah, there is a problem and I'm noticing. That itself can give you a kind of a kick. So, that answer your question?
Yep.
Okay. So, I'm just trying to summarize. So, I know that I've put a lot of things together because we had limited time and I want to maximize your value, right? So, the first one we spoke about team size and productivity, and we have seen that it's inversely proportional, and we have seen that the number is 4 to 5 or maximum 6, and later, we have seen that when the team size grows, what are the factors which is affecting? And we looked deeper into the social loafing phenomena. We have seen that social facilitation and social influence, how this is getting affected us on a daily basis in our work life as well as our personal life. And we have seen a couple of options which can be used currently now and try to improve your current situation. Probably it can help you in realizing some additional value. Yep. That's all I have. So it's open for some. Yep. Out of my research, I have done a lot of Googling, and I have even published a lot of references. So from these links and references, the books I've read, etc., I've realized that this is the ideal number. And this is one blog which I have seen and which I felt interesting about the team size. So it's not that 4 is the ideal number or 5 is the ideal number. It's depending on the context. it context really matters. But if you go more than 7 or 8, it's very difficult to manage. I think probably some of the audience also can talk about it if you have some experience. Okay. Okay.
And people tend to, sort of overpower a smaller group with more disturbing numbers. Where the numbers are more than 9, then the less experienced people don't tend to open up, and the lines of interaction, they start to increase a bit too much for a group to be innovative.
Yes, but exactly. Even when in Scrum, Alliance says that 7 plus or minus 2, right? When the Scrum team size, they talk about that, 7 plus or minus 2. So it depends on that. Even I used to give some exercises where we do some paper folding and different things. So there you will see an ideal number again. It may be 7, 8, depends on the situation. So context really matters. It's only about, the idea is that you don't, with the notion of us adding more people and getting more work done is not really true. So you should really think about this phenomena before adding more people and try to get something done more faster. Deadline is approaching. I have only 1 month. I have work left for 20 man-days, and I have only 5 people with me, and add 15 more people will not solve the problem. That is something which we should really understand. Yeah. Yes. This one? Okay. So, see, you can look at it in a little different way. Like, say, Kanban, for example, when we do Kanban, we don't have a habit of splitting it into small, small tasks. Rather, you keep a big story, and maybe one or two people working on it. But the idea is that with the moment they start putting that into a WIP column, make them responsible. Let them write their name. Let it be visible. So people will get a tendency that, yeah, my item is not moving. It's hanging around there for quite some time. So they'll feel, kind of accountability and responsibility within themselves. But if you can, look back about our Scrum way of doing things, we split it because we want to have parallelism. We want the highest priority item to be moving to the other side as fast as possible, the value chain, right? So the more value, if I get the highest priority item, as far as possible, that is what I am looking at. So, and nobody is forcing the team member to pick up the particular task. So he's free to choose the item he actually wanted to choose. Anything else? Thank you.